Hello, welcome to the Enginerdy Show. This is Mr. Pole.
I'm St. Jimmy.
I am D-Vitty.
Now what do we say?
Welcome to another episode of the Enginerdy Show. Our fake sponsor this week is Math Busters. We solve mysteries without doing dangerous experiments.
So if the math doesn't work, we try to break
the math? Will not
it's
work.
Busted. No, you just do the math and you're like, yeah, that couldn't work.
You put it on a whiteboard and then you take a sledgehammer to it.
It's like figuring out the difference between a parabola and a catenary.
No, not like that at all.
That's math.
You just made those words up.
Did not. It's part of my Minecraft addiction.
So this is going on YouTube, but it's not going to be live because that didn't work last week.
Live is not coming on the show, so no selling the drama here.
That'd be awesome.
I said it's not going to happen.
Next week.
Yeah, because if you met him, you wouldn't ask him.
You make that work.
I don't even know the name of the band members.
I bet we can find out.
Have you heard of Google?
Oh, I did hear where they're from.
England?
No.
Liverpool.
Band members of Live.
Where did I hear that? I don't remember. I heard that somebody else was from the same place as them.
We got Chad Taylor at lead guitar. Okay. We got Chris Chin, guitar.
And where are they from?
And Patrick Dahlheimer, bass guitar.
That's made up.
Where are they from?
They're an American rock band from Pennsylvania.
Oh.
You've probably met them before then.
York, Pennsylvania, to be exact.
Yeah?
York. Is that where they make the peppermint patties?
They were active from 1989 to 2009, and then from 2012 to the present.
So where would I have heard someone talking about...
Oh, there's a guy named Ed...
Someone from Pennsylvania.
Kowalczyk. I'm not sure what he does.
The Enginerdy Show.
Oh, lead vocals, rhythm guitar, and primary songwriter is Ed Kowalczyk.
Ed Kowalczyk!
Does he have one giant eye?
He does.
Wow.
Here's a picture of them. He's probably the bald guy.
Weird. Without the shirt on?
Or the redhead in the front. Oh, sorry.
Are they playing that live? Do they have live shows?
They do have live shows, amazingly enough.
You would think
all
their
shows are live.
Oh.
Well, how do you do a show that's not live?
You have a different band come.
I had a friend give me a piece of gum, and it was extra gum. I was like, if you have only one piece left, you don't have extra gum.
That's true.
And he blew his mind.
He didn't want to laugh, but he did.
Your logic is impeccable.
He attempts to not encourage my pun humor.
It doesn't take encouraging to get you going.
No, it does not. I'm enjoying myself.
Well, speaking of pun humor, I was going to put some jewelry in my beard so I would have a go-tiara.
That'd be funny.
I don't know. That was something I came up with the other day.
That could be a women's college... go tiaras.
Oh, yeah. Like a little girls' soccer team or something.
Yeah, there you go. Like in Fate of the Furious.
Yeah.
That was funny.
I knew he was not... Yeah, anyways.
Spoilers.
Spoiler alert.
Now I know there's some girls' soccer team in the movie or something.
Yeah, right.
And that there's like some kind of submarine with torpedoes.
Yeah.
I did watch the trailer, so...
That was after they were on the International Space Station.
That was after the credit scene?
Oh. Yeah.
Oh, that was after they came down from the International Space Station and landed on the polar ice cap?
Mm-hmm.
So, and it actually wasn't on Earth. It was Enceladus or something. Some Saturn moon or something.
Ooh, I could do some enchiladas right now.
Oh, yeah.
Enchiladas.
Saturn Enceladus.
Oh, there's
isn't Encelada like salad?
Yes.
I don't know.
Encelada.
I was speaking Spanish today.
Maybe I'm saying the name of this moon wrong.
I was reading Spanish because my AutoZone card is in Spanish.
Oh.
So I was reading the fine print on the back. When I got it, they didn't have any English ones left. It's like, I've got a Spanish one. I was like, sure.
It still works, same.
I think so.
Except your rewards are in pesos.
Oh, gusto, what?
Auto partes, accesorios.
Maybe they thought you were Hispanic when they gave it to you.
No, they didn't.
Oh.
Okay, so I think it was last week or something, we were thinking of our favorite Star Wars scene, or we were talking about it.
That was on the walk to work.
I wasn't involved in this conversation.
Well, I figured out what mine is.
Oh, okay.
Because I was arguing with somebody.
My favorite Star Wars scene is when Teal'c calls Admiral Adama and says, "Captain, there'd be whales here."
I don't think that happened.
Spoiler alert. Have you seen the new one already?
No, I just thought it would be funny to make...
They replaced Princess Leia with Teal'c.
Star Wars fans mad.
I was watching... Oh, that's another thing I could add on there. I was watching a bunch of things that are great about... It's a series on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And they're doing all the Star Wars movies, so I was watching them. And the guy had the opinion that's pretty close to mine about the last... This is a spoiler alert. Last scene of Rogue One with mm-hmm. Vader.
Yeah.
Where you guys finally get to see Vader at the peak of his power.
Mm-hmm.
Doing what Vader does best, killing
extras,
rebel scum,
red shirts.
Wrong franchise.
Rebel scum. Just going crazy. I love that scene.
I'd have to think a little bit to figure out my favorite Star Wars scene. I think it's when the Wookiee family is having their Christmas.
That's pretty good.
Just kidding.
I was thinking when C-3PO's head gets welded onto the battle troop. I'm just kidding. That one.
That's your favorite. I do like that. Yeah, I like that guy.
Oh, I did like the lightsaber battle with Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan against Darth Maul.
That's pretty good.
I did like that.
That's epic.
Yeah.
In
the book for episode 3, the battle between Obi-Wan and General Grievous is really good.
Oh, yeah. I liked that too. That was one of the great things about it was he has like a counter and he shows all the great things about each of the shows.
Mm-hmm.
And that battle, he really liked the part where he kicked Grievous in the shin or like
trying to trip his foot.
And he hurts his leg. Oh.
I like the part in the New Hope where they say lock the doors and hope they don't have blasters.
That's good.
That's a good one. We just watched that with the kids.
Or when C-3PO thinks they're getting crushed to death in the garbage compactor. That's great.
Yeah. Curse this metal body.
Yeah.
Boring conversation anyways. Luke, we've got company.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
pretty
so
much
funny.
My favorite is...
We're okay. We're all okay down here. How are you?
Weapons malfunctioned. How are you? But he talked about... We heard from Harrison Ford that when he was in the original movies that he was... the most experienced actor probably on the set other than like Al Guinness, but he's like he took the dialogue that they gave him and he kind of rewrote it for it so it makes sense, but a lot of the younger actors didn't have the guts to do that and he posited that might be why some of the lines are difficult in the first right. 3 episodes because everyone's so in awe of George Lucas that no one's willing to question his dialogue.
I also like the part in Rogue One where the robot's overplaying his role as having the two captive. And he, slaps him.
I like the part where she shoots one of the droids.
Oh, yeah.
He falls over, then he walks up. Did you know that was me?
Or did you think that was me? Did you know that wasn't me? Or something like that.
Right.
I also like the part where they're talking about them being exposed to space and all dying. Except for me, I can survive in space.
Yeah, that was good. Or when Vader says, "Don't choke on your aspirations."
That was awesome.
It's like, dad joke.
Yes!
Oh, watch out, the ceiling is low in here.
Low ceiling. Mr. Pulp can do that. I can do it.
You can sand people?
Yes.
I can sand person.
That's one of my favorite scenes, is them splicing together the same action repeatedly to make that guy move his arms.
We were watching A New Hope, and I was like, point out to Mrs. Jimmy, I'm like, hey, watch Han here when he steps over Jabba's tail. It looks weird.
It does look weird.
It wasn't originally, they didn't know what Jabba looked like when they shot that.
Right.
So,
couldn't you have had Jabba come into the scene and turn so his tail was...
Probably. I don't know.
Let's look too small, I think.
Yeah, well, maybe he had time to put some weight on.
I heard they're going to release the original, or the 4 through 6, untouched.
Original cut?
Except for on Blu-ray. I'd buy it.
Because Han shot first.
I might posit he was the only one that shot.
Han shot.
I always blink when they show Greedo shooting, so I don't have to see it.
Because Greedo's your favorite character? You don't like seeing him get killed?
No, I...
Oh.
I like Han shooting. Oh. I just don't like Greedo shooting.
Oh, okay.
Maybe Han shot twice and it deflected.
Oh.
One of them.
It bounced off of Greedo. Oh, anyways.
So I did something fun today.
Oh, really?
Yes, I left work early, and me and Danger Girl, my daughter, went to a book signing.
Let's get dangerous. What show's that from?
Darkwing Duck.
When there's trouble, yeah. You call DW. Darkwing Duck.
Yeah.
Second favorite, or third favorite, duck-based cartoon.
So the
Count
author
Duckula's number one.
The author we went to is named Brandon Mole.
The guy from
No, Night he's Court. Not. I don't think he's related to the guy from Night Court.
Well, let me mull this
is
over.
Is he tall?
He's probably about my height.
Oh.
He's about my age, too.
Is he bald?
Maybe he's his
And,
son.
Well, okay, he can't be brothers with, what was the Night Court's actor's name? Something
I
Mole.
It was Brandon Mole.
It wasn't Brandon Mole. Anyway.
Here we go.
Brandon Mole mentioned how he was the oldest of five children, and he's my age. So
tall, bald, Night Court actor.
He's not brothers with the Night Court actor.
They could be born 20 years apart or more.
No, Brandon
Mole.
Oh, he's the oldest.
Yes,
that's right.
He said he's the oldest.
Richard Mole, M-O-L-L.
Oh, so not related.
They could be cousins.
Maybe fourth cousins twice removed. Who knows?
That's oddly specific.
I didn't look it up.
Oh.
Anyway,
Google, is Brandon Mole related to Richard Mole?
So this isn't the first Brandon Mole DVD. Quit
I'm doing product placement.
Quit vamping for the camera. Anyway, this wasn't the first Brandon Mole book signing I went to with my daughter. We went to one 7 years ago as well.
That's a long line.
Yeah, it took us that long to get to see him. But he's really cool. He talked for about half an hour, answered a bunch of fans' questions, and surprisingly, even kids that were like as young as 10 years old were asking very poignant questions that,
like, are you related to?
No, like questions like you could tell the kid had really read the book and understand what was going on.
His parents prompted him.
No, I mean, the cool thing about Brandon Mole's books is they're written so that adults and children can both
listen,
enjoy
to
them.
The car.
What you should have done is been like, what's with all the typos? Like, don't you have somebody proofread those? Make him self-conscious.
No.
Have a copy of the book with a bunch of, like, tabs on it.
Like, look at all these typos. Like, who's your
but
editor?
When we were up there getting... My daughter brought, like, 7 books for him to sign. All hardcover books.
What, you
books.
Think it was Gilderoy Lockhart?
Well, you know, she got the other books signed.
Oh, did her
last
book
time
come
we
in
went.
Time?
No, she didn't.
Oh,
the one
it.
Book she was hoping didn't get there in time, so she's like, well, I'll just have to find out when he's in town next and get that does one signed then.
Did he remember her?
In town.
He didn't remember her, but she did mention that
away.
We had been to a previous book signing. And I mentioned to him that I had heard when he was a guest on the Bacon Sale podcast.
But failed to invite him on.
And he was like, oh, yeah. He's like, that was really fun. I didn't know how fun it was going to be before I did it.
You've been wearing a shirt that says Enginerdy Show.
Yes, I know. If I had worn my bright orange Enginerdy Show shirt, maybe he would have noticed it more. But I had my jacket on, so it was kind of covering it a little bit.
I was wondering if you were going to be wearing your jacket and ruin it.
Yeah. Well, I didn't want to carry around my jacket. I mean, it was more comfortable to wear it than not wear it.
Tie right. The arms around your waist. Yeah. Hello.
Loop them through the thing on your fanny pack.
I didn't wear a fanny pack. What kind of nerd do you think I am?
The kind that wears fanny pack?
It's been
actually Joe
decades
Rogan,
since I've worn a fanny
Joe
pack,
Joe Rogan
guys.
Wears a fanny pack, and so does Adam Carolla, so I think it's cool.
I had 2 fanny packs in the 90s, but I do not have them
and
anymore.
And for our British listeners, a fanny pack is not as bad as it sounds.
I didn't think about the British listeners.
My kids,
it's an Americanism.
For a bike trip they're going on with their scouts, actually convinced their mother to buy them fanny packs. But she forbade them from wearing them any other time to ride their bikes.
But they're like, it's so handy. It's,
I know, it's right there.
You can keep stuff in it.
They're very handy.
Yeah. Well, I've
store your Bluetooth.
I've had back problems in the past. And so Instead of a backpack.
Then he put it all behind him.
Yeah. Instead of a backpack, I had this giant fanny pack that basically could hold almost as much as a backpack, but it snapped it around your waist. And I used that.
And it makes you look like you're pregnant.
If you put your shirt over it?
You wear it on the back.
Oh.
I wear it on the side.
Yeah, you could wear it on the side.
Then you could wear two.
I also had a smaller, like, it said Eddie Bauer on it. Little fanny pack.
So like a,
it was styling.
Like a clutch inside of a purse.
I didn't wear them at the same time.
One inside the other.
Yeah.
They're nesting dolls.
This is the meta fanny pack.
This is, yeah. No, it wasn't like that. I did not come on this podcast planning to talk about fanny packs.
That's next week's nerdiculture.
What do they call them in England?
I don't know.
Nerd totes.
That's what we should call them.
Totes adorbs.
That's no moon. That's your...
No. I don't know. I'll look it up.
Okay. We are not going to follow that. We're going to cut that conversation off right there.
I decided not to make a comic about that when I said it earlier today.
Good job. You're showing so restraint.
Sure how I was going to do it.
Anyway, I have a complaint about... what do they call those? GPS?
Tourists of a certain age.
That doesn't, okay, anyway.
Can't tell us.
It doesn't say what they call it.
They don't have those.
Tells us what that means.
So, Neil, tell us what that means on Facebook. Not what that means, but what that's called.
Okay, this okay. is not making very good pod. Can't you call it a utility belt?
Yes, like Batman. That guy's got a utility belt. Yeah. That's totally cool.
Anyway, so the place we're going is a couple hours away.
Oh, so you're like traveling to Cairo from Zimbabwe?
Well, we had to take a ferry at one point.
Right up the Nile.
So we were following... So my daughter had her GPS going. And I think the GPS was not very bright. I think it was trying to take us directly to the ferry instead of to where you can line up to get on the ferry, because we ended up on this really steep dirt road that went down toward the water. And
it's a boat launch.
To be fair, we were pointing directly at where the ferry was as it was coming in. But I'm like, this is wrong. I don't care what your GPS says. This is not how you get to the ferry. So we turned around. I actually had to back all the way out of this place, and she finally figured out, okay, yeah, it's telling us to go this other way. But
pocket mate.
It was like, the GPS is trying to send us directly to the ferry. It's in the water, and it's trying to send us to it.
Go, you can make it!
It's like, what do we do when we get to the beach? Okay, now drive on the water.
Overinflate your tires.
Okay, the only thing I saw, they might call them bum bags. I don't think that's
no,
true, though.
Pocket mate is probably a good one.
Anyway, the fanny packs are so outdated.
Not really. I think they're coming back.
Oh, here. There's more corroboration.
Oh, I thought that said burn bag.
That's a little different.
I'm like, why would they call it a burn bag?
Because people make fun of you when you're wearing it?
Burn! Oh,
you got burned.
The 90s called. They want their insult back.
It's warm in here.
Yes, it is. Does that help?
A
when you fan yourself, rhinos. Does that really help?
Yes.
Oh, it does. I'm going to do it.
So the monitor in here is having more and more difficult time coming back on after being
it's
off.
So warm.
It's so old. So.
Oh, yeah. I need to get the advertising profits to you so we can buy a new monitor.
Yeah, we can get one of those Dell refurbished.
I have a note to myself, but I haven't acted on it. Anyway, that's behind-the-scenes stuff.
Not anymore. It's in front of the scenes
well,
now.
We're not talking about it
so,
anymore.
I know okay. we have a moratorium on having Ben from HappyCast on the podcast.
Mm-hmm. I don't think it's
we're
official.
We're not supposed to talk about that on the air.
Yeah,
but we he should... does such a good job with the Adventist that I would be interested in maybe having a segment maybe once every four episodes or something where he comes on and we compete with each other and something.
That might be fun. Is he up for that?
I have no idea.
Well, we could try it once before podcast. We make a commitment.
He doesn't
to do
listen
it
to our
repeatedly.
Podcast.
That would make it even better.
Brian,
only Brian
tell
does.
Ben.
Yeah, Brian, when you talk to Ben next.
Well, I think
Brian
I can
do it.
I have
that way we don't have to have Ben on. We can just have Brian on.
I have Ben on my Skype. I could.
I do too.
DM him
on my Skype, not yours. I don't know. I would have someone on your Skype.
Anyway. Alright, so...
Now who's playing to the camera?
Nobody knows unless they watch it on the camera.
You're not drinking out of that. Anyway, let's move on, unless you have more banter.
Nope.
Okay.
Nope. It
took you too long to think about that.
We're... All right, okay. Let's do some nerdiculture.
Nerdiculture.
Sorry, I was looking kind of on there, but
nerdiculture.
Tech culture and nerdiculture.
I think he says it's his birthday.
Bad lip reading of Star Wars.
Yes. Oh yeah, that was.
I went home and showed that to my wife. All right.
Anyway,
sorry. Look it up.
Plow forward.
I came across an article that was talking about a company that was had this idea that they were putting forward to try to get investors. Mm. It's basically like a
people trying to get
a LARP vacation, so live action role play vacation.
So like
it would be based Total Recall? Based on Star it's called Wars.
Running of the Bulls.
Oh,
and so you would go someplace for a couple days,
like Yavin,
and it would look like you were on a starship from Star Wars.
Oh.
And there would be characters dressed as Star Wars type things, and they have it so that you can either participate in the role play of a storyline that goes throughout the couple days, or you can just watch. But they also have things you can do like lightsaber training and stuff like that.
That actually sounds really fun.
So I was thinking,
I wonder how much
what other franchises would make good LARP vacations?
Predator.
Jaws.
I would not want to go on those ones.
2001 is Space Odyssey.
What are you doing, Dave? Yeah.
But like Star Trek would be cool.
That would be cool.
They have little Star Trek experiences.
Just have it in the park and see you're in a holodeck. Just short. To direct the arch.
You just go. And have it in the park.
We should get a portable one of those.
Just make one out of styrofoam and set it up in a park.
That'd be funny.
That would be funny. That. We'd have to videotape it. That'd be even funnier.
Obviously. So support the show so that we can afford an arch.
Build an arch.
What would you think about me having a section or a page on our website that is Minecraft pictures and walkthroughs and stuff?
That'd be fine. That'd be cool. Might drive traffic there. I made a change to the website that I'll talk about later.
Ooh.
So, what other franchises?
Smurfs.
Stargate.
Stargate would be kind of cool.
Smurfs, no.
It could be in New York.
Smurfs,
Fast and Furious. You could get a souped-up car. You could have a city street. You could leave your mile 1/4 mile at a time.
Master Zed went and drove at
Laguna Seca.
Laguna Seca in a... Fancy.
That's my favorite race course.
Mercedes. So at Universal Studios, I think I mentioned this, at the backlot tour, they have a section that's Fast and the Furious section. And it makes it look like you're immersed in the action because it's got one of those 360-degree screens, 3D screens. Right.
Can I mention that I actually saw a scene
in
Cleveland?
Yes, I remember that.
The land of Cleves.
That's right.
Yeah.
Is that where the Cleavers are from?
Yes. Leave it to Cleaver.
Did they name it that because Grover
My
was
favorite
born there?
Cleave age is the 70s. Don't mispronounce that.
Yeah. He's a Clevelandiac. I don't know. I was trying to think of a song that I could stick Cleveland into and that didn't work.
Oh, I know. A LARP vacation alien.
I like big people, but I cannot like...
No, thank you.
What about Resident Evil?
She drives me Cleveland. No. All right, stop. Cleveland and listen.
Nope, that doesn't work either.
Oh. I want a Cleveland right now. I'm Rob Bass and I came to get down.
Spaceballs.
Spaceballs. That would be awesome.
Spaceballs the experience.
Yes.
Is Mr. Coffee there?
Maybe.
Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
You can watch videos of the end of the vacation.
Here's your coconuts.
Fast forward.
That would be funny to do a quest for the Holy Grail LARP vacation.
You could go to each of the locations.
Yeah.
Ooh, Battle of the Black Knight.
Mountain Chop Ass.
And Tim the Enchanter.
And
they call me Tim.
Where, behind the rabbit?
He's the rabbit.
You could bring out your dead.
I do that anyways.
You could hit the cat against the wall to dust it.
Yeah. Oh, you could make a two-level effect.
Oh. With a herring?
You can chop down the largest tree in the forest with a herring! I don't think that would really translate well to a vacation. There needs to be some kind of storyline going, ooh, like Indiana Jones.
That'd be kind of cool.
You can have the
crushed by giant rock
face melt off.
Yeah, someone rip your heart out.
Yeah. Temple of Doom. You could eat monkey brains and...
Oh, yeah.
Wait, wasn't the guy that got his heart ripped out, wasn't he represented by Sandy Wexler? He was. That's from the movie.
Oh, yes. Which we'll talk about soon.
The Sandy Wexler LARP experience.
Let's see. Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
I don't remember that movie.
Oh. What, you just drive the wrong way on the freeway?
Have a normal
That was a John Candy movie, right?
Yeah.
Yes. John Candy.
We could do Blazing Saddles. No.
King Ralph.
What?
I don't know. It just quickly down in my under. Head.
Let's just name movies.
Oh, Brother Where Art Thou?
Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Oh. Get Lawrence Fishburne.
Yeah, is he in that one?
I don't know. Ooh, The Matrix.
The Labyrinth.
Oh, that'd be kind of cool.
The Labyrinth. I have a lot of puppets around.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, The Labyrinth. You just have David Bowie climbing up and down ladders
with Muppets?
With puppets. Muppets, yeah.
Sesame Street.
Can you tell me how to get?
They never do.
They never tell you how to get there.
I know, at the end of the song, it should just be like, nope.
Seven.
Oh.
Paranormal Activities.
Oh.
What's in the box?
You think
Paranormal Activity bed and breakfast.
No.
That would be so fun.
No.
What's the one where all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy? The Shining?
The Shining Hotel?
That's an actual hotel, so you can do that one. It'd be creepy if it's a bunch of twin girls. Wandering the halls. Just have a ball and a magnetic.
Which podcast was I listening to where somebody didn't like the clown from It?
Who likes him?
My wife doesn't like that actor, Tim Curry.
Oh,
is it Tim Curry?
Even in Clue? Oh, I know.
No, she doesn't like him in anything.
Maybe it was in Clue. Span the Void.
Clue LARP Vacation?
Yeah, with Tim Curry.
He's probably not doing anything.
You can have Indian food.
Okay.
Yeah, some Tim Curry.
That's right.
Mm.
Oh, did some...
He should make sauce like Newman did with the salad dressing. You could have Curry's Curry.
Yeah.
It could be in a Kirby bottle. Curry's Curry.
And then
Curry.
On it could say something about...
That's hard to say.
Floating.
And Madame Curie.
Madame Curie's Curry sauce. It's only mildly radioactive.
Interesting. G.I. Joe.
How hot would you say this curry is in Curry's?
Well, let me get my Geiger
Avengers!
Counter.
Avengers?
They kind of did that at Universal
Studios. I did the whole
stride.
Was that 2 days long?
No, it was just they had Avengers wandering around the park that you could stop and take pictures with.
I guess they used to have like Quark's Bar in Las Vegas.
Mm. Quark's Bar?
I think it was Quark. From
DS9.
Yeah.
Yeah, I heard about that.
That'd be cool.
The waiters and waitresses.
So if you went to a LARP vacation, would you dress up?
You'd have to.
Why else would you go?
Would they provide clothing, or do you have to bring your own period
for
clothing?
For a small fee.
I could do a Star Trek one. I've got a red shirt.
Yeah. You know what they do with red shirts, though.
I heard that's a misnomer, that they're not actually the most commonly killed color.
Someone was telling me that.
I don't believe
Somebody at work was telling me that. And I didn't buy it. I'm like, well, what were they counting as deaths? Were they counting...
When a ship blows
aliens?
Up?
Aliens? You know. Were they only counting Starfleet officers?
Thing is, if there's a group of people and one guy's wearing a red uniform, he's usually the one security, that's gonna die. Right?
I guess Scotty rarely went on away missions.
Right. Well, it's not that they don't get killed because they're wearing red. They're wearing red because they're disposable.
I was thinking they're wearing red because they're not either Bones, Jim's, or McCoy, or Jim and McCoy.
Right.
I said McCoy twice.
Spock,
Bones.
Oh, yes.
Bones and Jim.
Bones, Jim, Kirk, and Spock.
Bones, Jim, McCoy walk into a bar.
Montgomery, Scott. Yeah, someone said, well, Scotty never gets killed and he wears red. I'm like, well, neither do you, her, and she wears red. That's because
he was trapped in a transporter.
But, and Uhura does go on away teams sometimes.
That's true.
I could think of a handful of episodes. In the animated series, she even took command of the Enterprise.
Did she crash it into a planet? Like
no, she's not like Deanna Troi at all.
She's she'll never live that down.
First time.
She's actually captain. Competent.
She landed it mostly.
Mostly.
They walked away from it, didn't they?
I guess. They were under contract, too. When they crashed, all the red shirts died, but everyone else survived.
This is so weird.
Especially since the red shirts in that generation are the...
Abandoned ship! Oh no, personnel. The red ships got the torpedo tubes on accident.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Anyway, that's all I had for nerd culture.
Alright.
That's pretty good, though.
Yeah.
I would do it.
Sure. For Technergy, we're going to talk about a couple of articles I read about wind power.
We should put one outside Congress.
There was a group that was studying turbines and efficiencies. And
were they from the Middle East?
No.
Oh, do they hide fans up in those turbines?
Yes.
That's how they keep cool?
How they levitate.
Well, most of the giant wind turbines that are out there have very rigid blades on them. And so this group, I could pull up the article, but I'll just go off the cuff. I don't remember who it was. I think it was Princeton, actually, maybe. But they studied what would happen if the blades were more flexible. So they tried some like really floppy blades, and they were way worse for efficiency. So they tried some that were kind of in between,
silly putty.
And they actually were more efficient. So the problem with a rigid blade is it takes, there's a threshold where if the wind is too low, it doesn't spin at all. It has to get up above a certain amount, and then if the wind is too high, it can actually damage the blade from it spinning so fast. So the flexible one is interesting because they can design it for very low wind, but then as it speeds up, it deflects and it can actually prevent it from overspinning because it
drags,
because that's it changes shape, so it's not hitting the wind as much.
Oh, yeah.
So it's kind of like a compliant mechanism.
Yes. So it's pretty interesting. Because they're not rigid, they don't get the fatigue stress, so they last longer.
For our non-engineer listeners, sorry.
This may be
compliant mechanism means it's designed to bend and move. So
not like Congress,
but
right.
But the bending in this case is kind of like a safety feature that you want it to become less efficient so that it catches less air as the wind picks up.
So have you seen the new designs? That they haven't started building big ones yet, but it's got, instead of like blades sticking out like a fan,
they're kind of twisted
and they kind of go around. Yeah.
Yes.
Tandem almost.
Yeah.
It's like a DNA strand.
Mm-hmm.
Because that way, no matter which direction the wind hits it,
right, it doesn't have to turn to face the wind.
Yeah.
Yeah. They have rooftop models like that, too, that are supposed to be...
I think I saw it on...
bird safe. So they...
Is it fiddler safe, in case you have a fiddler on the roof?
No.
Oh. Okay.
You don't want the fiddlers up there, so you want one that's not fiddler
safe. If I were a rich man...
Would it be safe for my new online business I started, where I'm building boats in my attic? The sails are going through the roof.
That was good.
Yes. Yes, yes.
I'm like, are you planning for a major flood?
I love puns.
Yeah, so it was pretty interesting. We might see turbines with flexible blades. the next article.
I'd rather not see any turbines, actually. They're kind of ugly.
Well, that's why they're putting them offshore where you can't see them. And where the wind is generally stronger because there's no obstructions and more constant because it doesn't have topography to deal with. It's going over a flat-ish surface.
I still think harvesting the planet's natural heat is our best bet.
Okay.
Well, this is a good stopgap, I guess.
Right. For now, this group from University of California, Riverside, I remember correctly.
They should pair these with the Tesla batteries.
Well, what they did is they built a computer model of an entire grid on the East Coast that actually exists. So they had all of the current power supplies and all the loads with a realistic model. And then they modeled what would happen if they added certain levels of offshore wind power to it and how the grid would adapt. And they found that it could actually handle a lot of wind power, like up to 70 gigawatts or something. No, I think it's...
Gigawatts?
Gigawatts.
Yes. But the thinking has always been wind is hard to factor in because it's inconsistent, and then...
That's why we need to modify the Earth's...
Rotation?
Stratosphere.
Oh.
Or weather patterns, just so we can make it windier.
Well, what they found is that their ability to predict the wind has gotten better over the years, especially offshore, since they have more data. And they found that they could put a lot of the power offshore and it would reduce the need for pollutant generating onshore power generation. Hmm. So, and they're offshore far enough that you can't see them.
And that you can kill birds and not notice.
Right. Well, how far offshore are birds going to be?
A couple miles. That's how you know you're close to shore.
Okay, so maybe they're still in bird territory.
What about the albatross?
They're just...
What if you had an albatross hanging around your turbine?
What about dolphins? What if dolphins are jumping nearby and they get caught in the blades?
Hey, more for me.
Or porpoises. Maybe the porpoises jumped into the blades on a porpoise.
It's more. Like someone riding a porpoise?
Maybe you had a crab riding a porpoise.
Okay.
Under the sea.
Fishman.
Ariel.
Aquaman, I mean.
You got to kiss the blades.
Like, quick, jump into them to shut them down. We can't let the humans have that much power.
Instead, I want to be like human. Here, throw you through the blade.
They won't be able to tell your pieces apart from human. That would dark.
That would be funny if, like, dolphins figured out how to use the power from jumpstart their... What,
then you have a mermaid? Dolphin obesity problem because they're watching mermaid? TV.
Little Mermaid LARP experience. Now with helmets or scuba gear.
You could do like all kinds of Disney movies. You could do
Rapunzel.
What's the one with the Beauty and the
Black
Beast?
Cauldron?
I think it's called Sleeping Beauty.
You could be part of the mob that attacks the castle.
Sleeping Beauty and the Beast.
Sleeping Beauty and the Beast.
Oh, Lion King.
Beast. Duh.
This setting must have changed or something because it keeps.
That's very sensitive. Timing out. Sensitive.
All right, that's Technerdigy.
Excellent. So, because of the success of the previous foray into this, it's been decided that there's going to be 10 more episodes of X-Files.
Oh, all right.
With David Duchovny and what's her bucket?
Jillian Anderson.
And they're going to be produced by Chris Carter.
Oh, is Mitch Pileggi going to be in it?
I don't know.
Oh.
That's the one guy.
Is there anywhere to watch the new series that came out? The recent one?
Not the old ones, but... The one that were on TV?
Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't seen them yet.
Oh, you haven't seen them?
No.
I used to have them on my DVR, but I think we've since
Well, that doesn't help me.
You have to do a Google search and see if you can find them.
All right.
Well, but it was really fun to see those two back together again.
Yeah, I thought they had good chemistry through the series. So.
Yeah.
And that's the news.
Wow, thank you. Short and sweet.
Also, keep an eye out for a movie coming out soon called The Hitman's Bodyguard.
Oh, I saw the preview for that.
Does it have Whitney Houston in it?
No, but they do have the song in the preview.
Yeah. It looked really funny.
It's got
Samuel L. Jackson
as a hitman that has a bodyguard assigned to him. Because he's trying to be killed. And the bodyguard is that one guy.
Ryan Reynolds.
We talked about it last week. I
was going to think it was the guy from Dances with Wolves.
Which guy? Kurt
Tonka?
Costner, yeah. I was trying to make a bodyguard joke.
Oh.
But it fell flat.
Yes, not remembering names ruins, yeah, it ruins a lot of the jokes.
Frank Oz. I couldn't remember his name for like a while back.
And now you don't even remember the...
So now it's actually turned into a thing. So if I can't remember somebody's name, it's being Frank Oz.
Look out for snakes. Sorry. That's from MSDJK. Anyway, what's next?
If you want to support the Enginerdy Show, head over to enginerdyshow.com. You can click through there to Amazon to do your Amazon shopping.
At Walmart.
Yeah, boy.
It costs you nothing extra, and it supports the Enginerdy Show. There's also some t-shirts up there, like Mr. Pold is sporting, that say, when in doubt, thumbs out. So you can remember how to do the Vulcan LFG salute.
LFG said he bought a bumper sticker.
Oh, interesting. That. That's cool.
Yeah, the stick. There's also stickers.
Is he going to put it on his truck?
He's deciding whose car to put it on.
He better not put it on my truck. I don't like bumper stickers.
You can put it someplace other than your
bumper. I do, but I put them on the front neighbor's bumper. Truck.
You can a whole bunch of them go to the mall.
Just put them on everyone's car.
There was a comedian that talked about bumper stickers for other people's cars. Like, honk if you hate the cops.
Oh, man.
Honk if you smell bacon.
That's funny.
All right.
Yeah. Let's go on to consumption.
I think we both have a little bit of consumption right now. I'm going to talk about some movies I watched several weeks back, but I forgot to mention. Okay. Just because they're worth mentioning, I think. I watched Hook with my kids.
All right, we'll bend the rules this time.
You guys remember Hook?
Yes.
Yeah.
I have it on good. VHS.
Yeah. The kids enjoyed it.
I tried to get my kids to watch it, and it didn't get to the island fast enough. I lost interest.
No, my kids did okay.
Yeah. Anyway, I guess I didn't have very much to say about that, but...
Okay.
I also watched Cool Runnings.
There is a picture of LFG
in a bobsled?
No. In the place of John Candy.
Dressed as Rubio? Oh, really?
I took the movie poster. This is shortly after I met him.
Oh.
And I added him to the the poster.
Nice. I actually think that's one of my favorite John Candy characters was in Cool Runnings. But that's a really good movie. It still holds up.
Which one of the Jamaicans did he play?
He was the has-been bobsledder that coaches them.
Yes, I remember.
Yeah.
Never mind.
It's a good one.
It is a good one. I also finally watched the movie Arrival.
I've not seen it yet.
I haven't seen it either.
Okay, I won't spoil it then.
Redbox.
I won't spoil it then, but I have to say that it made me think of Doctor Who.
Who?
Yeah. Oh. Exactly.
It made me think of Dr. Seuss.
You haven't seen it.
Maybe think of Dr. Demento.
So specifically, when you think of Doctor Who, think that he's, you know, got this time travel machine.
David Tennant, okay. Got it.
David Tennant is a time traveling machine. Anyway.
Oh, he's in a time traveling machine.
And if you think about the Gallifreyan alphabet, it's circles.
Mm-hmm.
And the way they're arranged in different patterns make different words. And the reason for that is because the Time Lords, you know,
it's a circle.
Travel in time. And so if you have a circle, there's no beginning or end. And so that's kind of why they have
symbolic.
Kooky. Yes.
In more ways than one.
And
because letters are always symbolic.
I learned a little bit of it because my youngest daughter was interested in learning how to write stuff in Gallifreyan. And so
I think she wrote my name in it once.
Yeah. I think she was doing that during Christmas when we were all there.
Yes.
Yeah. So that was kind of fun. But anyway. I liked the movie. I really liked Arrival.
Good.
It's good.
I'll have to check it out. I've been meaning to check it out.
And it's got Amy Adams in it.
I don't know who that is.
I think she was in it. Or am I thinking of a different movie?
Is Arrival the opposite of Departal?
Yes.
Okay.
No, I think it was Amy Adams. Because she was also in that other movie I watched. The baseball movie that I talked about last week. The Curve or something.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, she's a pretty good actress. Yeah, that's her. Amy Adams.
And Jeremy Renner.
Oh, yeah, and Jeremy Forrest Renner's Whitaker. In it.
Oh, really? Yeah. Forrest Whitaker's in there, too?
Yeah, there's some good actors in there.
Oh, Forrest Whitaker was in the Rogue One.
So I recommend watching it. I rented it from Redbox.
Oh, so it is out in Redbox.
And then I was planning to watch it, but then my daughter came over, and I didn't watch it. And then, it was the night, no? Anyway, something came up. I didn't end up watching it till like 11 o'clock at night. I was worried I'd fall asleep in the middle of it, but I did end up watching it the whole time, so it was good. It was good science fiction.
Cool.
And then I also watched a movie on Netflix called Sandy Wexler. It's got Adam Sandler, and it's got
a
billion stick cameos in it. Well, maybe not a billion, but tons and tons of cameos.
Yeah, when he was on Adam Carolla's show, Adam asked him why he wasn't
invited.
And Adam's like, you were invited.
Oh.
You're just too busy. Because Dr. Drew was on it.
Well. So, the way I heard about it, and I had seen it pop up on the Netflix, suggestions, but I didn't catch my interest that way. But I follow what's his bucket from Hootie and the Blowfish.
Hootie?
The lead singer.
Dave Matthews.
The Blowfish.
That does country music now. I don't remember his name now, but I used to know his name. Anyway. Dave Matthews. It's not Dave Matthews. Anyway, the Hootie and the Blowfish guy, I follow him on Facebook, and he made a mention about having a cameo in that movie. And so that...
Tim McGraw.
Interested me enough that I...
Darius Rucker.
Yeah, Darius Rucker.
There you go.
Yeah. I like his Hootie and the Blowfish stuff. I also like his country stuff. He's a pretty talented singer.
Agreed.
And he was one of the cameos in that movie. And so I watched it, and I enjoyed it. It was a little strange at first. The character that Adam Sandler plays is a little over the top sometimes, but it's Adam Sandler, so you kind of expect that.
I thought it was funny.
But watching... The whole way through, definitely there was a payoff.
And it's heartwarming.
Yes, it was pretty good.
My heart's already pretty warm. So.
Just because it's warm in this room.
Oh.
Yeah. And I think that's about it for my consumption.
Okay. Well, DVD and I took our wives to see the new Fast and the Furious movie, Fate of the Furious. I really liked it. I thought it was excellent.
I liked it too. I do feel it would have been better with Paul Walker. I think he would have fit right in there.
Yeah, they should have brought him back from the dead.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I
could play that part.
I was tempted to say, just bring his brother in and just do like a Roseanne. We replace the actor and don't mention it.
Maybe like Bewitched?
Maybe his brother's not as good of an actor, though.
Probably he's not. I don't know, I think it's funny a lot of people claim that they're
bad
acting.
They should have got Paul Simon to play in the...
But having lived in California, I don't know. I think
Paul Reiser.
He did a pretty good job of portraying a Californian.
Yeah. It was good. There's
lots of action.
I heard people saying, oh, yeah, it's all action. There's no real story. But
there was a great story. Yeah.
It was good.
Man, you want to talk about hating a villain?
Charlize Theron.
You want the woman to die.
Yeah, she's
hard.
Really good in it.
She did a good job, yeah.
It's got The Rock, it's got Vin Diesel,
Jason Statham. Ludacris,
yeah. All the...
Michelle Rodriguez.
They didn't have any Ludafisk.
Had a baby.
There was cars.
Were there three men?
No.
It was
had it was, the one guy that played Jason Statham's brother for a little bit.
Oh, yeah, he was in it a little bit.
He was a Russian guy?
It was basically another episode of Mission Impossible with cars.
Hmm.
So
Mission Incarsible.
Yeah. The only other thing I watched...
Trust me, it works.
Okay.
...that wasn't a series I'm in the middle of was a film called The Midnight Meat Train. It started off pretty good. There was one point where I was like, okay, this might go sideways on us.
Mm-hmm. And it's hard for a train. Should have said it, but it was going to derail on us. That'd be a better...
It went off the rails a little bit. There you go. And the ending was kind of...
The jump the shark.
Manos Hands of Fate-ish. That's what it reminded me of.
They had a bunch of women fighting, wearing wispy clothing.
No. The very end.
Oh.
But it was okay. It was... Yeah.
Stunning review.
It's very gory. It's got a guy from Gone in 60 Seconds, the guy that plays Sphinx.
I have not seen that movie enough to know the
character. I just know
the guy that doesn't talk the whole movie, and he doesn't talk in this one either.
Nicolas Cage.
No.
When I can't think of Nicolas Cage's name, I call him Snake Eyes.
No.
Which is often.
And the main character is somebody you would recognize too, but I can't remember his name.
Bill Simon. Oddly enough.
Let me look.
The guy that played Pee Wee Herman.
Oh,
Paul
Reiser.
No.
Bradley Cooper is the main character.
Interesting.
And Leslie Bibb. Brooke Shields is in it.
I've heard of her.
And
I've heard of Vinnie Jones.
Vinnie Jones is the guy that plays...
He's a British actor that is always tough.
In Gone in 60 Seconds.
They probably have him speak because it has a very thick accent.
Basically, Bradley Cooper is a photographer and he's trying to get into the art scene instead of like his normal job, which is taking like crime scene photos.
Oh.
And he kind of figures out that there's this guy that's killing people on the subway and he can't figure out how he's doing it and getting away with it.
He's making him choke on sandwiches.
He ends up following the guy around and finds out there's this big thing going on. So it was interesting. If you're into gory suspense movies that turn out weird, go for it.
All right.
That's it for me.
So I listened to the Happy Cast, one of the Adventist episodes.
The third one?
Q on there.
Oh.
That's the third one.
Probably.
I really enjoyed it. I was laughing the whole time. I was trying to play along in my head with some of the questions. Some of them I was like, really? You guys don't know that one? But they did a good job. Brian has a wealth of knowledge.
Yes. It's rigged.
It's rigged?
I don't know. Maybe.
Was it rigged when I was on there and beat him? Or beat Ben?
I don't know. It was when I was on there.
I guess the exact
you weren't on number. The Abentus, though.
I wasn't.
Yeah.
You were on their previous...
We need to have a nerd dentist.
A nerd dentist?
Yes, a dentist that puts, like...
Dents in your nerd?
No, they give you, like, Star Wars-themed grill.
We instead of fillings, they give you nerds?
As a child, we had a dentist that had a TV nerds. Reset in the ceiling, which,
oh, yeah.
As an adult, thinking about how heavy those TVs were, it's probably not safe to have that hovering over...
Probably blocked in.
But he had a VCR hooked to it so you could watch movies while you're doing it.
I remember that.
I remember that too.
And I was always disappointed that Dennis didn't take long enough so I couldn't see all of Star Wars.
That
was usually what I watched.
You're like, could you start it at minute 27?
Yeah, I wasn't. I should have kept track of where I'd left off.
Well, you probably watched it multiple times between visits.
I did.
Probably.
So that was a very good episode. I enjoyed Q.
In 1982, we watched it every single day.
Yes, we did.
I was only 1 year old.
So you probably don't remember that?
No.
Okay.
Probably not. I don't even remember you being there. You were one.
I was invisible. The baby.
It's the baby. Eh, we don't know.
You weren't the mama.
I'm still the baby. No, I'm not.
Then I've watched a bunch of YouTube videos, just kind of went down the rabbit hole on Dr. Jordan Peterson. He is a professor at the University of Toronto. He's gotten in trouble because he came out and flat out said he was not going to use people's personalized pronouns.
Mm.
But he is a clinical psychologist. So a lot of good insight. I was watching one where he's talking about how to train your partner, like your wife.
Same thing. Do tricks like rollover?
Rollover, no. Honey.
It was basically that episode of Big Bang Theory where Sheldon is training Penny with chocolate.
Oh, I don't remember that
one. Oh, where he gets her to, every time she does something that he likes, he gives her chocolate.
Okay.
But it's more about small positive reinforcement repeated.
Mm.
And if you want something from somebody, his example was, let's say you come home from work and you would really like your partner to take it off the TV and come down and say hi to you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you don't, because they're not there saying hi to you, you don't go up to them and say, you're stupid, and you'll always be stupid, and you've always been stupid, and you're never going to be stupid. Oh, maybe that's what
I've been doing wrong.
It was over the top example. He's like, but at that point, you've backed them into such a corner, there's only a couple ways out.
Right.
Obviously, there's going to be crying. After that, they're is probably going to be,
well, I can't help it. Retribution.
He said, they should punch you in the face. They should. There could be violence. There could be all kinds of things. It's like, but if you came home instead said, I'd really appreciate it when I come home, if you could just for a minute or two come down and, you know, just say hi, give me a hug or whatever, then go back to doing what you're doing. And then he's like, when they attempt it, because new behavior in humans is not usually perfect on their first couple tries, you have to give positive reinforcement for them even attempting it.
What about nude behavior?
That'd be even better. Mm. I want you nude by the
front. Why are you looking at me?
Look that way when you say that.
This is not going to happen.
Anyway, you should do it once. That's a good advice.
Mess with him.
No.
We also talked a little bit about how people that suffer from depression, a lot of that is, let's say you have a structure, and let's say your structure of your life is you're a student, you're a college student, and you get a bad grade. It's like people that go through depression, oftentimes they'll go from that small little instant of getting a bad grade on a test to automatically saying, why am I even in college?
Hmm.
You know, just going to the macro level immediately instead of trying to cut off the path to the macro level by saying, well, I'll study harder for the next test or something. And going forward, where people that go through depression oftentimes go macro and go backwards. So they relive and blow up their whole... And if you blow up your entire world like that, then you're floating around not in a structured environment anymore. And that can...
Objects in the mirror are larger than they appear.
There you go. That kind of reminds me of... I was listening to an episode of the Tackling Life podcast with Ray Lewis and... I can't remember his co-host's name.
See, I thought it was Tackling
Conte
Wife.
Or something like that.
I got in big trouble.
Yeah.
Or not Ray Lewis.
Anyway, Ray Lewis is on there with a psychologist guy. And the psychologist guy was talking about how depression comes from dwelling on the past and bad thoughts about the past. Anxiety is dwelling on the future and bad thoughts about the future. And he said, the best is to dwell on the present and live life presently. I thought that was a pretty interesting way to put it.
And Dr. Peterson also has a program they put on the internet that was free for a while. I'm not sure if it is anymore. Called self-authoring.
Self-offering.
That's different.
I offer selfs up.
That's like walking down the street at night. Anyway. Where he uses it in his class, you know, with his students, where he has them break their life into six epochs of, you know, important, and then break those down into an important...
I prefer to call mine epics.
Epic epoch?
Yeah. This then, epic part of my life.
Then picking one really pivotal emotional, like, moment in each of those to write about.
Oh, okay.
He's like, some of his students have gone on this assignment end up writing 15,000 words. But
what if you don't have emotions?
The stuff he tells you to write about, a lot of times
had emotions.
Is stuff that causes... they kind of actually made me think of Spock's brother, because a lot of it, he's like, if you write down and go through and think about and actually in writing...
Oh, yeah, Star Trek V.
Write about experiences that, you know, had negative impacts in your life and your psyche.
Mm-hmm.
oftentimes it will rewrite your path, or most of the times, he said, it will end up rewriting pathways in your brain, and will kind of, then your brain will, they'll click into your brain and it makes sense.
Hmm.
Because stuff that has affected you they haven't taken care of will actually constantly cause cortisol to be released into your system, which is a stress hormone, until your brain can come to settlement on things that have happened. Hmm. By writing it down, it does that. And he says people can really change their lives just by writing about their past, and especially, you know, emotional things.
So it's like cathartic?
Yeah. He's like, if you think about it and are telling someone a story of something in your past, and you get that feeling of stress, which I get oftentimes when I'm talking about my past experiences with court and police officers and stuff.
Oh, uh-huh.
That still affects me when I start talking about it. So maybe I should try to do that with that. But
I just block it all out.
Okay. But he said cortisol is something that makes you old. It's an old hormone.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why I'm young for my age.
Yeah, that's why I look so young.
That's right.
I'm actually 80. No, just kidding.
So check out... I'm only
72.
He's quite
thought we were 6 years apart.
Yeah. The way when you explain get that stuff age, just it doesn't matter.
Makes sense. You're like, well, I never thought about that before.
Huh.
You're actually aging faster than me, so that's how that works.
Is it just because I have gray hairs?
So one of my favorite ones is watch him on Joe Rogan's podcast. It's like 3 hours and 20 minutes long, but which is the longest I've seen him go. Oh, I take that back. He had Steven Crowder on for almost 4 hours.
So like half an episode of those conspiracy guys?
Yeah, but Joe Rogan, I think either him or Adam Carolla have the most viewers or downloads.
Hmm. Is Joe Rogan the guy that was on Fear Factor?
Yes.
He's on News Radio.
News Radio?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
I thought I'd
also did, name. Does broadcasting for
MMA.
Yeah, MMA
or
fights.
Or UFC or one of those.
Yeah, UFC, I think.
Yeah, he was good in News Radio. I like that show.
He's a smart dude, and he has a very open mind.
Was on Netflix.
He has people on his show to interview him, and usually, unless you get them talking about pot, he's usually very open-minded and will let you talk about whatever you want in depth. So anyways, that's my consumption.
I think I just breathed into the mic.
Oh, man.
Stop. Don't copy me.
It wasn't me, it was you.
I didn't do it on purpose.
No, if someone fesses up to something, you hurriedly do that thing, so then
you can
falls under
blame
theirs.
It on them?
Yes.
That sounds bad. Well, should we talk about MST3K? Since we watched...
Oh, yeah, we watched that.
An episode of the new with series?
Jonah.
The, Reptilicus.
Yes.
Reptilicus.
Oh, man.
So bad science. They brought up the fact that lizards, when you cut their tail off, regrow their tail. Yeah, but the tail doesn't regrow a lizard.
Yeah, but then they talked about how a starfish, if you cut one of their
starfish
arms off...
Starfish don't have brains. Not complex brains, anyways.
Yeah, a lizard is more complex.
Way more.
Nervous system than a...
They also brought up earthworms, which is also the same thing.
It was good.
Yeah, it was funny.
It was funny. The intro, like the beginning theme, I didn't like it as well as the old one.
Oh.
But
you're talking about when they tried to set up the whole...
I like the part where he's talking about monsters through the world, from the world. They had little placards of little cuts of the monsters.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that was funny. Yeah, the interstitial segments were all good.
They're pretty good.
But you mean the part with Will Wheaton at the beginning, where they're...
Oh,
yeah.
Kind of putting a framing story about how they get to where they're
at. It was just... I don't know if that's the part that struck me as not as good, but... I don't know. Maybe so, it was the actual theme song.
Well, didn't they use the one from when Joel was the host?
I don't remember.
Next Sunday, A.D. Da-da-da.
It was this,
probably re-recorded.
It was the same words, but it was done slightly differently.
Hmm.
I don't know. I'd like to watch it again and see how I feel about it. But that part, I was kind of like, eh. But I liked Jonah. It was funny. So they talked about how one of the characters, the only character or actor in it was that was known was some comedian.
Mm-hmm.
Which character was that? Was that the dumb guy?
I don't know.
Oh.
Wasn't it like a...
Because it seemed like they
Scandinavian
went...
Scandinavian comedian.
Yeah, they went out of their way to do some dumb jokes with him in the actual movie. Like, all the power's out, even the electric eel. Stuff like that. It was pretty... Yeah, it was funny.
It was good.
I recommend it.
Yeah, we need to
go watch it.
We need to watch some more of those.
Yeah.
I've been watching more of the older ones that they have on Netflix, and it's almost like a best of that they've got on there. Puma Man's hilarious. Space Mutiny is pretty funny. Pod People with Trumpy the alien is pretty entertaining. Jack Frost, I think I mentioned that one last week, is pretty good.
I think I've heard of that movie.
Yeah. And then I still haven't watched the Time Chasers, but I know I've seen that one.
Yeah,
several
I've seen
times.
That one too. Is that the one with the Cessna?
And they they go back in time.
Oh yes,
you've got mail, pattern baldness. Oh, right. Yeah.
Is that where they came from?
Yes,
I use it all the time.
Yeah. Anyway, we should plan another movie night.
Okay, let's do nerd cred.
All right, well, my biggest nerd cred is I got my t-shirt
in
the mail, and I wore it to work today. I even wore it to the Brandon Mole signing. But
I'm wearing mine tomorrow.
Talk about that.
It's in the washer right now. I got to put it in the dryer.
Yeah.
It did smell like glue. You're right.
Yeah.
So if you get a shirt, wash it.
And I got some nerd props from a nerdy coworker of mine that are the most nerdy one.
Did you tell him the hand is modeled after actual letter
voice? I didn't.
I
should have, but... He was very impressed. He said
it was very difficult to get the to get the text right.
Yeah, but it's an awesome shirt. I look forward to wearing it more often.
Cool.
I'll put it in my rotation.
I can't wait to wear it tomorrow.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
So if you go to our website, enginerdyshow.com, you can now find the Amazon link in the menu instead of in the episode description.
That's a good idea.
Oh, that's a good idea. That was one of the constructive criticisms LFG was talking about, was having an easier way to click on the Amazon link.
Yeah, and then I don't have to remember to put it in every week, because I'm like almost done. I'm like, oh, I forgot the Amazon link.
You're smart.
So now it's right here.
It says Amazon.com.
Amazon.com. You click it and it takes you to Amazon.
Very nice.
And just do it once and you can bookmark it and it'll support the show.
You can get better equipment.
Yeah. I also took apart my son's Nintendo 2DS to repair it. So when we bought it for him, we bought this case for it. So if he dropped it, it wouldn't break.
Was it full of oatmeal?
No.
Oh, okay.
I think it was like made by Nerf.
Oh.
But it messed up the shoulder buttons, so they didn't work even after he took the case off. So I took it apart, and the bottom of it had bent the plastic so far that it was jammed up in there. So I had to just kind of bend them back and break off pieces to make it work. But it works now. So
cool.
It's pretty sweet.
So last week I talked about... Here, I forgot my...
You're Fast and the Furious.
Fast and Furious metrics.
Metrics.
So, here I had three different ratings: IMDb, Rotten Tomato Critics, and Rotten Tomato Audience Scores. So, I'm going to start with the audience scores. It was way off. Because of it peaking and going back down, because of the vast difference between 4 and 5, it put a pretty sharp curve back on it. I think it was a third level. Yeah.
Okay.
But anyways, so it came out saying that it should get 57 with the audience on Rotten Tomato.
Oh,
but the actual audience score falls closer in line with the last three movies, in that it hit 81%.
Oh, wow.
Which is less than Fast 5, Fast and Furious 6, and Furious 7. So it's just one below Furious 7, which was the last one. I came closer with my critic score. I predicted a 63, and it came up with 67.
Oh, wow.
Then IMDb, I'd put a 7.3, which is out of 10. And IMDb... 7.3.
Whoa, nailed it.
Nailed it.
Awesome.
So I'm pretty proud of that.
Good job, man.
Which I'm glad, because earlier when I checked this, earlier this week, it was 7.2, so it's adjusted better with more scores probably and got to where it should be.
Just never check it again.
That's right. So I got to save this page just like this. And then, let's see. Oh, yeah. So, because of this, I did another Excel work. This was not as nerdy. It didn't have equations in it. But I was curious who had the most box office draw out of In Living Color or Saturday Night Live.
Okay.
So I went through every 10 years of Saturday Night Live. So 75, 85, 95, 2005. Found all the cast members.
Mm-hmm.
Found out their, how many, their, so the box office money for all the movies they were in.
Mm-hmm.
And totaled them.
Okay.
Who, out of those groups and In Living Color, so you got, what, five Saturday Night Live castings and In Living Color, would you think had made the most box office?
95.
95 is pretty good. What do you think?
In Living Color.
It was In Living Color.
Oh, wow.
It was by... It wasn't really close, even.
Oh.
And part of it was put way over the top by the $5.3 billion of box office that Chris Rock has gotten.
Hmm.
And he wasn't an all-the-time cast member, but he had... He was on there. We had a repeating character.
Hmm.
Of course, you have...
Jim Carrey.
Jim Carrey is a big one.
Mm-hmm.
Who went by James Carrey back then.
His,
all the weigh-ins.
His rendition of Ice Ice Baby is hilarious. It's
the greatest thing ever.
Look it up on YouTube.
Now, the weigh-ins, brother, that brought in the most money and was a little surprising to me, I think it was... it wasn't one of the older ones. It was either Sean or... Was it Winan?
Hmm.
Anyways. It's very interesting. 95 was pretty strong. There's quite a few people in Saturday Night Live that were in the billions also. But Chris Rock has been in 41 feature films.
Oh, wow.
So it helps, I guess.
Yeah.
But there's a good portion of Saturday Night Live people that never made any money in the box office.
Hmm.
But there's also so many of them that are...
I was thinking 95 because I think Sandler was in it on that year. And he's made tons of movies.
Mike Myers has a lot of money. With not as many movies, but right. The ones he has are awesome. So, yeah, it was interesting foray into...
$1 million.
So it was in the billions. But the Chris Rock thing kind of threw me... He was at the most of any of the people on any of the list.
See, I don't remember him in Living Color.
He played like a homeless druggy guy.
Weird.
There's only four cast members were in Living Color that were in every single season. I think it was Jim Carrey, the Wachutu fighter from... Ace Ventura 2. Can't remember what his name is. Jamie Foxx is also in Living Color, so that helped
too.
So he's been in a lot of good stuff. So yeah. Damon Wayans.
Cool.
He's in some of my favorite movies.
And then what else you got for us for Nerd Cred?
Oh yeah. So I decided in my Minecraft world I'm building the Idaho State Capitol building, but I wanted to put some more buildings in, so I decided to go with the Thomas Jefferson Memorial, which is the St. Louis Arch, which is big. It's 500 and some feet tall and the same width as it is tall.
Are you going to make it in the game so that it's so tall you can't see the top?
Probably.
But are you going to hit the... Is there a limit on how tall you can go in that game?
I think there is, but I should be under that, depending on where I start. I might have to dig down for the base, maybe. But I thought it'd be cool to line it up with my Capitol building, so from a certain angle it'll look like it's like enclosed by it, like it's surrounding it. Pold and I have been in it, the actual St. Louis Arch building.
That's true.
It's crazy scary.
It's not. It's great.
Yeah.
This is when I learned that DVD was afraid of heights.
So the shape of that arch, a lot of people would think would be a parabola, right? That's a common one that people think of.
Au contraire.
It is not. In fact, it's not even a catenary, which is another type of curve.
It's a dogenary.
It's a flattened catenary.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And part of that, and it's also not really that either, because it actually is thicker at the base and is at the apex.
Mm-hmm.
So it's... something a little bit different even still. But a catenary, that's going to be interesting what catenaries are. Plotted next to each other, it looks very similar to a parabola.
I prefer dogenaries.
A catenary is flatter at the bottom.
Wait, isn't that a veterinarian that only deals with cats?
Yes, I'm sure.
Anyway, sorry.
But it grows quicker.
Oh.
So it starts out flatter, but then gets steeper, quicker. And it's actually based on an equation that has a hyperbolic cosine involved.
Kind of like me.
Yes.
So the equation for it is more really cool. Hyperbolic than hyperbolic.
So the shape is basically what happens if you take a thin chain and hold it by two ends, and the loop shape it makes. That's a catenary.
Okay.
Huh.
So you could get the same effect with if you had a chain that was thicker at the ends and got thinner at the apex.
Mm.
It would take on the shape of this flattened catenary that is the St. Louis Arch.
Hmm. Cool.
So there you go.
That's interesting. All right, our final segment is feedback. We got a lot of feedback this week. We got two new registrants on our website, Jaden and Rochelle.
Now they just registered for the website, or do they want the...
I don't know. It just said new user registration, so...
Yeah,
they probably want they probably want the newsletter. Why else would you register on the website?
So I should send everyone that registers for the website the newsletter?
I don't know. Is that a lot of people?
I don't know. It's more than I have now.
Well, ask them.
Do you guys want
the new person?
Oh.
Do you know any of them? If you get into our email, it's in the thing. It shows more than their first name.
Okay.
And LFG commented on YouTube that he just ordered my tea. So I think he ordered a t-shirt. He doesn't spell check himself.
So it's make a new t-shirt that says just ordered my tea on it. And we'll gift it to him.
Okay.
On Facebook, Rob commented on our link to last week's show that it didn't work.
Did you fix it?
Was that true? You don't know.
Well,
it didn't work for him, obviously.
I think he was trying to watch it live, and did not work live.
Is it because
live.
We blocked the UK from going to that? Just kidding.
Well, not all of it, just his region.
Oh.
Well, it's too pretty. Know what region
you should be outside Rob is to a podcast.
In. You can listen to podcasts outside.
You can?
Yes.
Oh. The live stream last week did not work, so I apologize. I didn't know it was going to do that.
We've had many problems live streaming the show.
Yeah.
Weird.
That's why this one is not going up live.
Well, we didn't have people watching it live anyway.
Well,
not that they could.
they did try.
They tried.
We saw people get on, and then they would jump off because
it wasn't working. Yeah.
So apologize for that. Matthew and Neil also liked our link or our episode on Facebook, so thanks guys.
Thanks, Matthew and Neil.
And Master Zed replied that Mr. Pold was correct and rugby players can be called ruggers.
I don't make this stuff up most of the time.
And he's thanked us for watching him play.
It was fun. I enjoyed it.
Well, thanks for telling us about it and having us come.
On Twitter, Neil, I should have pulled this up because I'm trying to remember. Oh, I can pull it up.
Okay.
On my phone. Matthew mentioned that he likes mods on
Minecraft.
I just ate at Mod today. Mod pizza.
Oh. I've never done mods on Minecraft.
Mrs. Jimmy's done that.
Cal Texaco or something.
Oh. Cal Ripken.
Cal Lexico. What they do is they have chicken and then they have jalapenos.
That's racist.
And
I don't know.
Buffalo sauce on it.
Chapolino.
And some, I don't know if it was like, it was some kind of cheese. I don't remember the name of the cheese, but it was really good. It was super tasty. My stomach did not agree with my mouth, though, because it didn't like all the heat from the jalapenos and the buffalo sauce, but anyway.
Okay, so Matthew said, mods are my favorite O-A-R-T-T. I don't know what that means. But then there's a picture of his Minecraft loading a mod.
Oh.
My kids play mods all the time. I don't know what that would be.
Well, there's a lot of things you don't know.
I know.
Oh, here's what
apparently there's a dragon.
Neil sent. American football.
Thanks, Neil. That was funny.
We got somebody liked our G.I. Joe Pinterest thing again. Someone named yes! Lynn. So
thank you, Lynn.
It's funny since we haven't even looked at that in years.
I know. People just randomly pin it.
Cool.
I don't even know what it is. I don't think about G.I. Joe's.
Bad guy, what is the bad guy's name in He-Man, the woman one? Is it Shadow Lynn?
Maybe it's her. I don't remember.
I'm sure it is.
I wonder if we should try to see what is on her Pinterest. Because I remember I loaded some stuff up there, but I don't remember what it was now.
Well, the G.I. Joe thing is very popular.
Excellent.
Isn't it one with, like, Shipwreck and... I can't remember the other character.
Is Polly?
It's starting to...
Was it Flint?
I don't remember.
Bazooka?
I just said I don't remember who it is. You naming names is not helping me. Something
about sports. Okay. If you want to contact us, our email is enginerdyshow@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook and Twitter. Sorry, we're at enginerdyshow. You can comment or rate us on iTunes and Stitcher, and
just don't berate us.
You can also comment and get the newsletter at enginerdyshow.com. While you're there, click on the across the just under our logo are some links. One of them will take you to our t-shirts.
Wait, they're like cats?
Yes. Link? Yep. They're little cats. You click on them. One of the cats takes you to where you can buy t-shirts.
Those are the ones with like the little cuffs on their ears.
For $50, you can buy a show-worn t-shirt. Like a game-worn jersey.
Buy this t-shirt that Mr. Pole is wearing right now. He'll even sign it.
I will sell you the shirt off my back. This is a Walmart one I got. This is...
You can also get the same thing that's on the t-shirt on a sticker.
You could also go to our website and buy a shirt that has not been pre-worn.
Yes, they're a little cheaper. Those.
I'm not sure why you'd want that.
They're cheaper than the worn ones.
And there's a new button on the crossbar that takes you directly to Amazon to do your Amazon shopping.
All your shopping at Amazon.
Supports the show a lot, and we thank you for it. Thank you for listening this week. Stay nerdy.
Live long and nerdy.
You have been and always shall be, my friends.
And it's a wrap.
And it's hot in here. Open the door.
Okay.
We probably could open the door earlier.
Whew. Wow.